Only a few days away from learning who will be the winner of the most consequential vice presidential pick in modern history. And I mean that sincerely. Most of the time, the VP pick, you know, really doesn't matter. Little known answer to a trivia question. Like, if you ever find yourself on Final Jeopardy during the Tournament of Champions, this one might pop up. The vice presidential choice of the Democrats in 2016. Who is Tim Kaine? Yeah, that's right. The gigantic human zilch named Tim Kaine was actually the vice presidential pick of Hillary Clinton in the last election. Like, who? Tim Kaine? It's true. Look it up. Now, I'm not saying Joe Biden is going to pick somebody better, but given that Joe Biden was born before Calvin Coolidge, the VP pick has a certain raised significance this time around. Biden's campaign is saying that they will name the VP sometime next week, and that's the thing. We are in the middle of election season right now. It's here. For perspective, let's look at the calendar. We are less than 3 weeks away from the Democratic Convention. 3 freaking weeks! The Democratic Convention is 19 days away. Then the Republican Convention is less than 4 weeks away, 26 days. We are 2 months away from the first presidential debate on September 29th. 8 days after that, you have the VP debate on October 7th. Another 8 days, and you have the second debate on October 15th. One more week after that, you have the last debate on October 22nd, and then 12 days till Election Day. We are 97 days away from the election right now, but that's really misleading. It's only 51 days until early voting begins in some states, and that's assuming these schedules remain the way they are with the pandemic. Again, that means people in swing states like Minnesota and Michigan will be voting before any of the debates actually happen. This, for lack of a better word, is bonkers. If your hopes for Trump winning revolve around him wiping the floor with Biden during the debates, keep in mind that 8 different states will begin voting before Trump and Biden begin debating. And basically, every state that has early voting will be accepting ballots before the final debate. So with all that in mind, let's look at the VP possibilities. And with that, we'll look at the markets on Predictit.org. It's an investment market where you can make real money predicting the winner of political contests. So this is people putting their money where their mouth is. Now, because of textbook sexism of the Biden campaign, we can completely eliminate half of the population that happens to be male, which I guess is somehow okay. And the chances of it being a white woman are pretty low, too. And it's not racist to pick someone based on the color of their skin, which he is heavily hinted at doing here. Of course, you know, that's totally fine. And he's promised to do the exact same thing for the Supreme Court. But let's just ignore the racism and ignore the sexism and move on. Let's just kind of toss that one aside. Let's start near the bottom of the list with someone who has the word bottom in her name. Keisha Lance Bottoms. She's the mayor of Atlanta and was actually one of the favorites for a quick second a few months ago. There are a couple of boxes that Biden needs to check with this pick. Keisha Lance Bottoms checks a couple of them. Number one, the correct skin color. Number two, the correct genitals. It's kind of like the main things he's looking for here. But she fails an important test. Will she be seen as someone who can step right into the role when Joe goes to the nursing home in May of 2021? Honestly, a mostly unknown mayor of Atlanta, who looks like she's in her late 30s, honestly is not going to work here. I don't think it's going to work. She now has only a 1% chance to win it on Predict It, so she's kind of towards the bottom. Bottoms at the bottom. That's the same place of people like Stacey Abrams, Tulsi Gabbard. There's a bunch in that group. People that have been in the conversation maybe, but really have absolutely no buzz right now. In fact, they're tied with Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden at 1%. Honestly, would you be surprised if Biden came out and said, my selection is a senator from Delaware, Joe Biden? I wouldn't be. anything can happen with Joe Biden. Next up, Val Demings. She's at 4% on Predict It. She's a 63-year-old congresswoman from Florida. She checks off the first two boxes, the correct skin color and the correct genitals. She's only been in Congress, though, for a couple of years and is completely unknown. I mean, so she doesn't really check off the Joe's senility replacement box. She was the and this is such a strange way for Democrats to be going right now. She was the police chief in Orlando until 2011. She had some controversies of excess force by officers. And what did she do? Well, I mean, she may have been right in these cases, but she defended the officers. Now, I don't know how that works in today's Democratic Party. I mean, they want to defund the police. They have this, you know, a police chief they're going to run as VP. She's also been, this is tough. This is tough for me to say. I don't want to say this, but I have no choice here. She's been a bit of a loser. I mean, she lost her congressional race in 2012. She lost her mayoral race in Orange County, Florida in 2014. Is someone who lost a mayoral race in 2014 going to become vice president of the United States? She beat a Republican in a tight race in 2016. Maybe she has a little strength with some moderates. She is from a swing state, which, you know, is good, but doesn't usually mean all that much. Voting record, she's kind of like in the middle of the Democratic Party. She had a little bit of movement, though. She was kind of in the middle of the Democratic Party, and then this past couple of years has gone way left. Easily, you could say that that's showing ambition. Maybe she's lining it up for a run. But I still don't see this one happening. There was a lot of talk about her a couple of weeks ago. She seems to be out of the running right now. We'll see. We'll see. Joe might not even know who it is. He may just say random words, and it comes out Val Demings. We never know with Joe Biden. Next up is Tammy Duckworth. Now, she comes in at 5% unpredicted. If you've been watching the show for a while, and I love you if you've been doing so, you know she's been kind of my dark horse pick. Tammy Duckworth, she kind of checks the first two Biden boxes, which are very important. She's a person of color. She was born in Thailand, which gives us a really fun birther comeback if she's picked. By the way, she is eligible to be president. Her father is a U.S. citizen. She's pretty impressive on paper, though. Her family has been reportedly serving in the U.S. military all the way back to the Revolutionary War. She has a master's in international affairs, kind of a hot button for Creepy Joe. And that, and if you're like, you know, 11 years old, those are his two hot buttons, foreign affairs and 11-year-olds. And she has a doctorate in human services, which honestly seems like a made-up degree to me. What does that even mean, human services? She was a helicopter pilot in the military, though, and she was hit by a rocket-propelled grenade. She was the first female double amputee in Iraq. She won a Purple Heart. She has, you know, she has a real story. And she's, you know, she's a legit war hero in my book. I mean, I have no problem saying it. She ran for Congress and lost in 2006, and then worked at the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs, and then ran for Congress again in 2012. She won a couple of terms there and then ran for the Senate in 2016, where she blew out Mark Kirk, if you remember him, an incumbent Republican who somehow had a job in Illinois. Her voting record is basically middle-of-the-road Democrat. She's not AOC, but she's not Joe Manchin either. Here's the bad news, though, if you're Tammy Duckworth. She was kind of given this test drive for the role a few weeks back, and it did not go well. You know, she said she was gotten a fight with Tucker Carlson, and she tweeted something like, "We got to walk a mile in my legs." It's like, all right, and that's not. That seems like a pretty ugly way to be talking about this. She said she would listen to arguments about banning Washington statues. I mean, come on. But she was the first senator to give birth in office. I mean, well, actually at the hospital, not at the office. I mean, I hope. I didn't see it actually happen, so I don't know for sure. Karen Bass is up next. She's at 7% unpredicted. She's got some buzz. George Will wrote a column saying Biden should pick her. But I don't get it. I got to be honest with you. She's a total unknown. She's 66, so she doesn't bring the sort of generational change thing to the table. She's mega liberal. She'll have tons for Republicans to go through, including nice words for one Fidel Castro. She has some progressive race credibility, I guess, but mostly it seems like it's downside. A lot of downside and very little upside here. Makes no sense to me, so she'll probably be the pick. I mean, it's Joe Biden. He's probably picking out of a hat. Elizabeth Warren is the next one up. She currently stands at 6% unpredicted. I mean, she hits the first two boxes, obviously, correct genitals. Congratulations, Elizabeth. And she's a person of color. She's a totally authentic Native American. But none of the rest of it makes any sense. I mean, she's way too progressive. She's going to annoy lots of people in the middle, which this would be a very good pick, I think, for Donald Trump. She has tons of baggage. She's really bad on the campaign trail. Did anyone notice that she already blew this race once when she had the lead? She would probably outshine Biden frequently. I mean, she's much more of a darling of the left and the media than Joe Biden ever has been. The only thing she brings to the table is the impression she's ready to do the job, which she quite clearly is not. But the left thinks that she is. Okay, the top two. Number two, somehow, is Susan Rice. Right now, she's at 24% on Predicted. Seriously? The only thing anyone knows about her is like Benghazi and spying on the Trump administration, other various scandals she's been intertwined in over the years. She does have a lot of government experience and foreign affairs credentials, but when those credentials are involvement in scandal revolving around dead ambassador, I'm not exactly sure that's a positive. Biden reportedly loves her, though, and my guess is if she does not get the vice presidential role, she'll get something. She'll get a plum gig, you know, if he wins, a Secretary of State or something like that. I could see that happening. She's got the main two boxes checked: skin color, genitals. She could also make the case that she's prepared to step in, I suppose. She's been in the White House a lot. She's been in government for a really long time. She has some level of experience, but no one, you know, she doesn't seem to have much of a personality. No one knows who she is, really. There's a lot to unearth from her history, and most of it is not pretty. Plus, most people don't know about it yet. This is one of those things that, like, if you're listening to conservative media, if you're listening to talk radio all the time, you might know Susan Rice. You might say, Susan Rice, are you crazy? But to everyone else, to most people, she's not even known. No one knows about this stuff. They'll learn about it if she's picked as vice president. And all these scandals she's been involved in would come to outshine any positive that she would bring to the table. In a way, this is sort of the Tim Kaine pick, you know, that style. I select someone who seems kind of really boring and hope we're all locked in our houses for the pandemic on election day and nobody votes. Maybe Joe wins 2-0. You know, like that's kind of the play here. She's never run for anything before. How would she perform? No one really knows. It's a pretty risky pick. Sort of like, I don't know if it's as risky, but it's sort of as risky as keeping an ambassador unprotected in Libya. Not that risky. And at number one on the list, leading the field, Kamala Harris. You might remember her from her presidential run in which she turned fawning media attention into absolutely nothing. She had the goods to kind of put herself in the lead for a time, which is not nothing. I mean, she does have some political talent, it seems. Of course, her only really great moment in the campaign came when she basically called Joe Biden a racist. So if she is the pick, you'll know Biden agreed with her, I guess. This is another kind of prosecutor or cop sort of person that doesn't seem to be, why are prosecutors and cops so heavily represented on this list for a party that wants to defund the police? I don't even understand it. It might be, and this would be smart, so I feel like it's probably not true, but it might be the Democrats' effort to say, look, we're not against law and order. I picked a prosecutor. What are you talking about? I mean, all the left is really crazy. They're mad at us for choosing this prosecutor. And maybe people in the middle will say, well, I really don't like what's going on in Portland, and I don't like what's going on in Seattle. But, you know, I mean, I don't think that's Joe Biden. That is one of the key things they're trying to do in this campaign, is convince you that Joe Biden isn't those other people. Joe Biden's not one of these guys who's crazy. He's not an Antifa guy. He's like a boring old fuddy-duddy. You know, that's who he is. They might see chaos in the street as their weak point, and then they're playing into it. You know what I mean? And Kamala has some political talent. She will probably outshine Joe frequently. It's a recurring theme in this list. And if things get bad, I will promise you this. With the utmost certainty, Kamala Harris will be stabbing Joe Biden in the back all over the media. She is not a team player. This is the sort of pick, man, you do not want this. This is like, you know, this is like picking a problem receiver on your football team and just messes up the chemistry. I don't know. I wouldn't go this direction if I were him. It's risky. Part of the reason she's kind of seen as a favorite is a political article that went up to profile the potential choices. Do we have that in there? If you kind of see this, it's a little small for me to read here. But the bottom line is it says, hey, Kamala Harris won. She is going to be the person who is, Joe Biden picked her on August 1st. Now, this stuff does happen. We work for an internet company, and this stuff does happen sometimes. Sometimes it's not some leak. Like, they probably wrote a Kamala Harris one and a Val Demings one article, and they just posted the wrong one. Was this just an oopsie? Did they already write the article in case she was chosen, or do they have inside info? We don't know. Also, Joe Biden made the now apparently common mistake, which is bizarre, of showing his handwritten notes to the press. Now, you can't really read it from this angle. It's really tiny print, but his notes talked about Kamala Harris and her pros and cons. We know she's on the short list, that's for sure. And she's the overwhelming favorite of the predicted markets at 61%. Now, there's a couple of crazy outlier picks that you can always talk about. Hillary Clinton? No way. Plus, half the nation will go all Jim Jones Kool-Aid on themselves simultaneously if that happens. Barack Obama? I like this one. He's not prevented from being the VP technically in the Constitution. It's sort of the Vladimir Putin strategy, which is, you know, you could see the Democrats liking that for that reason. It's not going to happen, but I could see Joe Biden forgetting what year it was and saying Barack Obama anyway. It's possible. And of course, the elephant in the room, Michelle Obama. Look, it's kind of a long shot, I will say, and she'd probably only do it if she had a real strategy to get the top job. Sort of an Underwood family strategy, you know, minus Kevin Spacey and all of the molestation of teenage boys. The worst part of all of that is that the country burns to the ground in a disaster that would be even worse than season 6 of House of Cards. Hi, Stu Bergier of Stu Does America here. Thanks so much for watching our video. Did you know you can watch our entire catalog for free right here on our channel? Subscribe now and be sure to hit the thumbs up button on all the episodes you watch, because that's how they know you like this stupid show. And that little bell in the corner as well, make sure you click that. You'll get notifications every time we post new content. Stu Does America, every weekday at 8 p.m. Eastern, right here.